Happy, oh, it's not, it's Thanksgiving, just see. And there was a ball game yesterday. I don't know anything about that anyway. Good morning. Welcome to First United Methodist Church. We're glad you're here today. It's a great day to be in the house of the Lord and to begin Advent season together. This is the first Sunday of Advent, a special time as we rejoice and celebrate the coming of our Lord. Our ushers are coming forward and they're going to pass out the attendance pads. Thank you in advance for all the information you provide us there. Just pass it down the pew and then pass it back. And make sure you know everybody on your row and greet them today and make them feel welcome. We appreciate that. While you're doing that, get out your bulletin. Several announcements there that I just want to just highlight real quickly. First of all, note that tonight at 4 o'clock, actually this afternoon at 4 o'clock here, we will have our annual Healing Heart Service. This is a special time as we enter the holiday. We know that many of you have lost loved ones in recent months and days and even years. And we want to reach out to you and to express our love and share some encouragement. And we want to invite you to that service at 4 o'clock. Then tonight at 6 o'clock, a special service. And I'm going to ask David to come and make a quick announcement about our hanging of the greens tonight at 6.
It's had a couple of years off, but the traditional worship design team, yes, there's a group of people who helped design our worship services, said, you know what, we really would like to have the hanging of the green service again. By the way, my pastor growing up reprimanded me on Facebook. It's actually hanging of the green versus hanging of the greens. He said that's for collards and cake. Hanging of the green service will be tonight, and this is a fantastic informal but educational service, especially for our younger ones, to see the symbolism behind all of our greenery and to decorate the church and to get us in the spirit of Christmas. So tonight at 6 o'clock, again, come as you are. We'll sing some nice carols and we'll all get to participate in the hanging of the green around the sanctuary, and it'll be a great service.
And our sanctuary looked beautiful. Tonight will be the special lighting of the tree, and we're excited about that. I want to take a moment to thank Roy and Karen and Sandy and Terry and Marcy and I don't know who. There's a who? Ronnie and Eric, yeah, okay. And the list is a long list of folks who've come all week, been here all week, decorating and making. I walked in here today and just went, yes, it looks so beautiful. I'm just so happy. So I'm just kind of giddy about Advent and the holiday season. Also tonight, one of the things that I really love on the hanging of the green, I thought it was greens, anyway, bring a special plate of cookies or your special Christmas treat, and we'll all put it all together tonight and have a little afterglow after the service. That'll be a fun time as well. Ashley Watts, I want her to share a word with you about a super event that took place this week. The Ruth Spurrier Christmas sale happened, and I'll let her tell you. It was awesome.
Thanks. I'll step up here. Good morning.
Good morning.
I just wanted to tell you guys and thank you all for all of your help with the Ruth Spurrier sale. As you guys know, that used to be the toy sale several years ago, and we kind of transformed it a little bit. Our Sunday school class, the Class Acts, kind of took that over, and we decided to take kids shopping that had kind of aged out of the Angel Tree programs or the Toys for Tots programs, but still needed a good Christmas. So we were able, thankfully, with your all's help, to raise quite a bit of money, and we took 37 teens and youth out shopping this past Monday and Tuesday. In addition, Hope Circle was able to sponsor several of the children, but also take them all out to dinner at BW3's, which I think was probably just as exciting to them as going shopping. When we were able to tell them they could order whatever they wanted from the menu and they didn't have to worry about it, all of them got dessert and had a great time. We want to thank the Family Resource Centers here in Franklin County and Frankfort that helped us put all of this together, and all of the volunteers. We had a lot of shoppers that met us at Kohl's, and Kohl's did a great job at giving us discounts so that each child was able to spend $285 apiece. Wow. And when we told them that, their eyes lit up. It might as well have been $1 million to most of these kids. I took about 3 or 4 girls shopping myself, and one girl, we didn't know what size she wore. She was probably about 16 years old, and she said everything she'd ever had been hand-me-downs. And she said usually she wore sweatpants and sweatshirts to school because that was what she was able able to have their hand-me-downs. So it was really fun getting to have some of these girls dress up a little bit. They were all excited to wear their new clothes to school, and they were really, really appreciative. So we had a lot of great volunteers to help do this. We also want to thank the youth. We collected backpacks the last couple Sundays, and the youth stuffed those with school supplies. So in addition to getting all the clothes and the shoes, they were also able to get a brand new backpack with all sorts of supplies. And then also First Needles knitted scarves and hats and gloves for them. So they also got a full set before they left of a scarf and a hat and a glove. So they walked away with a really great Christmas. They were very, very appreciative, and we're really happy about how the Ruth Spurrier Project has really turned out the last couple years to try to revive it and hit an area of the community that really kind of was missing out through all the other programs. So thank you all to all of your help. We were able to raise quite a bit of money, and thank you for everyone that donated. Hope Circle now has a little bit to carry over into next year. So then this year we did 37 youth. Next year we maybe even be able to do more. So thank you all, and we really appreciate it.
Thank you, Ashley. Wow, what a great report. Thank you. You know, part of our vision is that we'll be a place where lives are changed, and I'm going to tell you, because of Ashley and our whole team, many lives were changed for the better, and we give thanks for the opportunity that this great church had and all those who participated in that. One other quick announcement about something that's not in your bulletin, and that is tomorrow night, right here in this room, the Capital City Chorale will be singing. We're doing a Christmas presentation here with special guests that you're going to love. And we want to invite you to come be a part of that. Many of our church folks are in that chorale. Plus, our own Ray Hurley is the director. And we look forward to a wonderful night of music here in the sanctuary tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. You can read all the other announcements that are happening there with great events coming up in December the 10th. Our youth will be doing a special, presentation. It's going to be a multifaceted presentation that you're going to really love. We'll tell you more about that next week, but that's on December the 10th at 6 o'clock and goes on to 8. So it's a 15-minute deal in different increments. So be planning to get your family together to take a little trip to Bethlehem that night. And then on the 18th, of course, our special presentation that evening called Gloria. You're going to love it. Now, friends, let's stand and let's greet one another.
You got a lighter? Oh.
It's great to be in the house of the Lord and celebrate this Advent season. And so let's prepare our hearts now as we worship God together. Thank you. Now let us await the lighting of our Advent candle.
The Son of Man is coming, but about that day and hour, no one knows.
Neither the angels of heaven nor the Son, but only the Father.
Keep awake, therefore, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming.
Therefore, be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. We light the first candle of Advent to remind us to keep awake and be ready.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And now will you please stand for the reading of the call to worship? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Lord is getting us ready to receive a gift of great joy.
Watch this gift.
Be vigilant and ready, for the gift is about to come. Watch, wait, the gift is coming to the world. Praise be to God for such lavish love. Amen. Please remain standing for hymn number 196, Come, Thou Long Expected Jesus.
Be seated. Hear the Old Testament lesson for today, found in the book of Isaiah, in the second chapter, beginning at the second verse. In days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains and shall be raised above the hills. All the nations shall stream to it. Many people shall come and say, "Come, let's go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways and that we may walk in his paths." For out of Zion shall go forth instruction and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations and shall arbitrate for many peoples. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, and neither shall they learn war anymore. Friends, as we gather together today on this first Sunday of Advent, we go to the Lord in prayer, and we bring to this place experiences from all across the land, some good, some joyful, some we're rejoicing in and some we're concerned about and hurt. And so let's bow our heads and let's go to the Lord in prayer as we lift our hearts to God. Holy and mighty God, Creator and author of our salvation, hope, joy, peace, and love. You, O God, are all those and so much more for us. As we gather together today and we offer our lives in prayer to you, we give thanks for the blessings that you've bestowed upon us. And in this Advent season, Lord, we come to you expectantly. We wait. We prepare. We put our hearts, our trust, our life in you, O God. For you are the God of promise. And you have never, never broken your promises. Today, Lord, as we worship here in this place, we give thanks that as a family of God, we can come together. We can pray and we can give you praise. Part of our purpose is to glorify your name, and we do so with our hearts and our voices and our lives. We thank you, Holy God, for the blessing that we have to be able to pray and know that you hear our prayers. You are with us, O Lord, in all the circumstances of life, both the good and the bad. We're thankful, O Lord, that you never abandon us. And today, in this season, more than any other, we recognize your presence. Lord, we pray for the sick and the hurting today. And there are many in our community of faith that are healing. They're undergoing treatment. They're undergoing rehabilitation. And you, O God, are their strength. You are their healing through Jesus Christ. And we give thanks for so many that you have gifted in the area of healing. Thank you, Lord, that we are witnesses. We thank you today, O Lord, that you also are our comforter. You touch us when we lose those that we love so dear. And in these seasons, God, our hearts seem to be penetrated even deeper. And we thank you that you come in and you fill us with that, the voids that we have with that love and goodness that only can come from you. Lord, look at our lives. You know where every one of us is in this room. Many are in the midst of great decision making. Some are in the midst of change. But Lord, you are there. And so today, we rejoice knowing that you're our God and our Savior. Lead us, O Lord. Lead our church in this community. Lead the leaders of our nation and world, and protect those now that protect us. We give you thanks, O God, as we unite our hearts and our voices, and we pray together the prayer you taught your own disciples to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The New Testament lesson comes from the book of Romans. Paul's letter to the church at Rome in chapter 13, beginning at verse 11. Hear these words. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reveling or drunkenness, not in debauchery or licentiousness, not in quarreling or jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. We want to invite our children to come forward.
Good morning. How's everybody? Good? Everybody have a good Thanksgiving? Have a lot to be thankful for? Today, what looks different in here? Yeah, we have the Chrismon tree, and what's up here? Anybody know what that's called? The Advent wreath. How many blue candles are there? How many big white candles is there? So how many do we light today? So how many are left? Four. So guess what 4 weeks from today is? Christmas. Can you believe that? So we have Thanksgiving and Advent happening all at once. The word Advent means coming. So what's coming? Christmas is coming, and who is coming? Santa is coming, and who else? Jesus. How about Jesus? Jesus is coming. So what we're doing in Advent is we're thinking about the past, that even before Jesus was born, there were people that knew that Jesus would come, and they prayed for hundreds of years waiting for Jesus. During that time, while they were waiting for Jesus, probably the same time that Mary was pregnant with Jesus, people didn't even know. They didn't know. They had to wait, and through the story, what kind of people told about Jesus in the Christmas story? Who told? How about the angels? Yeah, the angels. And the angels, who did they tell? They told shepherds. They did tell Mary first. You're right. You're right, Houston. You're right. The angel told Mary first, and the angel told Joseph second. But the angel told the shepherds, and the angel told the wise men. And you remember, that's how everybody knew. So it was, we all have a job to do. Back then they had a job to do, to tell about that good news, and we need to tell about that good news because we need to tell people about Jesus' love now. So that's what Advent, every week you're going to get something. You're going to get something up here during the children's time, and I'm going to go ahead and get it now. And the way today, I was thinking that when we have Thanksgiving, thank you, Matthias, that we have Thanksgiving and we're thankful for things. I want to say thank you because some of these gifts came from somebody in our church named Diana Eads. She wanted to give something to all the kids, so she wanted to give something so that we would remember the Christmas story. So every week you're going to get something that'll help you remember the Christmas story. So I have some books that have stickers in them, and everybody gets one. And those of you that go with me to Little Church, we're going to talk some more about Advent. But I just want to encourage you to look every single week and see maybe there's going to be something new in here every single week that reminds us about Jesus coming. All right, let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for Advent. We thank you that a long, long, long time ago, even before Jesus, people were getting ready for you. And I thank you that when Jesus was born, people were getting ready for you. And I thank you that after Jesus was born, people spread the good news, spread your love. And I ask that you help us do the same thing. As we remember all the things we're thankful for, help us remember to share that thanksgiving and that love to other people as we spread your love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let the congregation stand and turn to 216 and let's sing, "Lo, How a Rose Ere Blooming." Lo, it came a floweret bright, Remain standing for the reading of the gospel lesson today found in the book of Matthew, in the 24th chapter, beginning at verse 36. Hear the words of the Lord. But about that day and hour, no one knows, neither the angels of heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. For as the days of Noah were, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day Noah entered the ark, and they knew nothing until the flood came and swept them all away, so too will be the coming of the Son of Man. Then two will be in the field. One will be taken, and one will be left. Two women will be grinding meal together. One will be taken and one will be left. Keep awake, therefore, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. But understand this. If the owner of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Be seated. Well, today is the first Sunday of Advent. It starts the church year. And it's a day when we begin the preparation of the coming of Jesus Christ. We begin by lighting a candle, an Advent candle. We sing the Advent hymns, and we wait. We prepare. Advent is a time that seeks to take us back, to simpler times without the frantic pace that has come to define who we are today. We celebrate ways in which Jesus comes to us. We celebrate, for example, by remembering Jesus' birth more than 2,000 years ago. We reenact that birth through the children's plays and the youth dramas and so forth. We celebrate Christ coming again among us now, most notably through the prophetic word. And you heard the scripture already this morning. We celebrate how Jesus comes among us through one another. Do you see Christ in the faces of your neighbors? We see Christ in the least of those, of our brothers and sisters. I love this time. I love the children's voices. I know the parents are going, oh, be quiet, please be quiet. But you know, friends, listen to the voice of God when you hear the children. Listen to them. So we celebrate. We celebrate Jesus' second coming, when he will again come to judge creation by bringing a time of peace and joy that is spoken about so eloquently, and I shared that with you in the book of Isaiah today. So we're talking today about the end. It seems weird to start the season with the end, but it's coming. Of that we can be assured. And then what? Or then when? The answer to that is, I don't know. I don't know when. There are a lot of people who want to know when. They want to spend a lot of time. They want to spend a lot of energy trying to figure out what day will it be. Since the days of Christopher Columbus, you know Christopher Columbus wrote a book called The Sayings of the Prophets, in which he tried to prove the end time date. He sure did. And it's been going on ever since, maybe even before Christopher Columbus. There have been a rash of people who have worked diligently to tell us what time that would be. And thus far, they've all been wrong. This has been an ongoing forever, as I said, but most of the predictions, though, are around bad news. Have you noticed that? They talk about earthquakes. They talk about fires. They talk about torment. They talk about the stuff of good movie effects, but not very good theology, friends. Certainly not good biblical study, that's for sure. I mean, millions and millions of dollars have been spent on second coming books, for instance. And they make so much of those final days, and they pray, P-R-E-Y, they pray on our fears and our anxieties. And it might be an exciting read, but friends, it's certainly not based on biblical fact. And we can know that based on what I just read to you in the gospel lesson today. We will not know the time. And to assume that we can is to presume that we know more than the Son of God. And yet, you know, time. Time is important to us, isn't it? Time is important to you all? You all like time? Yeah. Me too. When I think about time, I always think about Jeff and Janelle Youngblood. Jeff had invited Janelle out on their first date. Janelle put on beautiful makeup and a nice dress, and she looked fabulous. And then she waited. And she waited. And she waited. And after an hour or so, she went up to her stairs to her bathroom and took off her makeup and changed into her pajamas. She got a pint of ice cream and sat in front of the TV. She thought she'd been stood up. After another hour, the doorbell rang. Yep, you're right. It was Jeff. She opened the door to greet him, and he looked at her, and he said, "I'm 2 hours late, and you're still not ready?" Time, friends, time. You know, we desire to know when the end will come. It's part of who we are. And if we knew when the end would come, though, we'd do pretty much as we like, right? I mean, retirement funds and pensions trade upon the certainty that the end for us will hold off at least until we're 80. And yet the truth is, you know, we don't know who will see the sunset tonight, let alone turn 80, right? Now from our text, from Matthew, he speaks of the ordinariness of this coming. People, he says, will be eating and they'll be drinking, they'll be getting married, they'll be baptizing their children, they'll be out working in the field. And that makes sense, right? Because what might happen in the future doesn't excuse us from doing what God requires of us now, right? And if we know when the end is near, the temptation might be to put ourselves in a little bubble, you know, to hide away in what we used to call bomb shelters, or maybe in a fortress up in a mountain somewhere, and we would wait, do nothing. But that's not what God calls us to do. Instead, we live here, now. And we live with uncertainty. An uncertainty of what will happen, but with the certainty that Jesus Christ will be in the midst of it with us. You see, when we would stop trying to figure out the when, we would have the energy to be able to do what God calls us to do now. Advent preparation, friends, is about removing the noise from our lives so that we can hear, so we can see the coming of Jesus Christ among us. Matthew spells that out pretty clearly. If you were to read on in the 25th chapter of Matthew, you would read the great judgment scene. And there, those who have been condemned will say to Jesus, "Well, if we had only known that you were in the poor and the hungry, we would have fed you." Yeah. Jesus comes to us today, friends, in the least of our sisters and brothers. And Advent is a time. It's a time to watch. Otherwise, we might miss the coming. If we ignore and we trample our neighbors today in an eagerness to be religiously correct and watch Jesus come tomorrow from heaven, we won't be prepared. Here's the deal, my friends. We are called to live in a constant readiness. We are called to live by being attentive to Jesus, who gives us hope for today and tomorrow. If this were your last day on earth, friends, how would you live? My question really is, if you're not doing it now, why aren't you? You see, the place of our worship, the place of our community gathered together in faith, it's been on my mind for a lot the last many weeks. Apostle Paul said, don't neglect being together. As I have spent a lot of time this last year being with families who've lost loved ones, it's become increasingly clear the importance of our faith community as we support one another. My family, we cannot do this by ourselves. We need to make more time, more than just meeting here on Sunday morning. We need to make more time in getting together, in growing in our faith understanding, to strengthen our spirit, and of course, to worship. We need a safe place where we can ask the hard questions about faith and know that we won't be ridiculed. We need that. We need a time for getting together. We need a time, we need to take our time together seriously, but we need to do it with joy and hope. See, our hope is in the one who is to come. Our hope is in the one who is among us right now. Our hope is in the one who's already been here. That's the mystery of our faith. We are to heighten our awareness of Christ's coming. Yeah, we live with uncertainty. I know that, you know that. But it's an uncertainty in those things that really don't matter if our certainty is in the one who is with us and will continue to be with us, Jesus Christ. My family, hear this. Advent is a time for us to refocus and regroup. Christ came as a baby, and we celebrate that. Christ will come again, and of that we are assured. The Christ comes into our midst today, and that is our living now. And so we begin. We begin this Advent. It's a time of preparing for the revelation. It's a time for full disclosure, that is, of Jesus in the joy and the sorrow, in the laughter and the tears, in the comedy and in the tragedy of our daily living, right here and right now. To that I would simply say, O come, Emmanuel. Let us pray. Holy God, we live with this uncertainty, but today we seek to understand what this Advent season can help us understand about our past, our present, and our future. Move among us, Lord. Make this Advent real to us in ways that we have never experienced. Come alive in us, live in us, Holy God, and we give you thanks. In the name of the living Christ we pray, amen. Friends, as we respond to the word today, our ushers are preparing to come forward. So let's prepare ourselves to offer our gifts and our tithes to Almighty God.
Let us pray. Holy Father, we do not know what the future brings, but we look to the future with anticipation. We face the future with confidence because we know you go before us to guide our path, and you walk beside us to give us strength for each day. As we anticipate your coming, Lord, we build your earthly kingdom with our tithes and our offerings. Accept this portion we give back to you and bless it for your kingdom's work. Amen.
Turn in your hymnals to number 213 as we sing, "Lift Up Your Heads, Ye Mighty Gates." It's a great honor today to be able to introduce to you Maxine Wells. Maxine comes from the Erlanger United Methodist Church in Northern Kentucky, and she transfers her letter today. And Maxine, I ask you the question that's been asked of all the members of the church, and that is, will you support the church with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness?
Yes, I will.
Then I want to extend to you the right hand of Christian fellowship and welcome you to First United Methodist Church.
Thank you so much.
God bless you. God bless you. I want to invite you to stand here with me, and I'm going to let people come and greet you at the end of the service. Ramona, you can stand there as well. He goes, okay, all right. It is great to get our season of Advent started in such a great fashion, and I look forward to seeing you this evening at 6 o'clock for our hanging of the green. And now, God, as we go from this place, we do thank you for your blessing. Thank you for the opportunity to anticipate what's coming. We put our trust, our faith in you. Give us now your peace, the peace that passes all understanding. In the name of Christ we pray, amen. God bless you. Before you greet one another, let's sing, "God be with you till we meet again."